Timber Press and Workman Audio present Uprooted, A Gardener Reflects on Beginning Again by Page Dickey. Performed by Alex McKenna. I am in the condition of a transplanted tree which is hesitating whether to take root or begin to wither. Anton Chekhov. Leaving. We walked away from 34 years of making, nurturing, loving a garden. How many thousands of perennials and bulbs did we leave behind? How many flowering shrubs? Hundreds? How many trees did we plant young and watch grow and stretch, becoming flowering umbrellas, casting shade, and turning fiery in the fall? We left behind the drifts of flowers that only happen with the passage of years. Snowdrops, winter aconites, spring phlox in the woodland, foxgloves,
verbascums,
Johnny-jump-ups, poppies, larkspur in the graveled gardens, lungworts spreading their haze of blue in the back of the borders. I thought I would always live at Duck Hill, that it would be my last house. It wasn't big, a simple farmhouse, old and quirky, with small, book-filled rooms littered with down-cushioned sofas and chairs in faded linens and chintz.
Forgiving, frayed oriental rugs on the floor.
There were enough bedrooms in its rabbit warren to house our children when they came home, and, in later days, their wives and husbands and their children. The kitchen, the heart of the house, was spacious, with a great old garland stove, shelves of crockery, a long table and chairs in the middle, and doors opening onto the terrace and garden. It is so American to turn our backs on a home and move on. And American, too, that in a matter of months, it is all wiped away. Those drifts of flowers, those fragrant shrubs, those young trees. Even the old farmhouse is torn down, obliterated, to make way for the structure that is the new owner's house. And now this strange place, no longer my home, is on the market again. Why did we abandon Duck Hill? Our cost of living, for one reason. Our oldest son looked at our finances and said we needed to save money. And residing in New York's Westchester County, 60 miles from Manhattan, was expensive. Then the garden, if we were being honest, was becoming too much for us. 3 acres of intensive plantings, hedges to trim, borders that needed constant editing, roses to prune, flowers to deadhead, a large vegetable garden to tend, a woodland garden to care for, a meadow to weed. My husband, Bosco, was turning 80, and I, 6 years younger, was nonetheless finding the maintenance a challenge. Our garden had gained some notoriety over the years, and we welcomed a constant stream of visitors who wanted to see it during the growing season. The pressure of keeping the garden up to snuff, especially as the sultry heat of summer set in and it became jungle-like, weighed on me. We didn't want to hand our garden over to hired gardeners, nor could we afford that as a solution. And our futile attempts at simplifying it were laughable. I replaced some of the neediest perennials in our mixed borders with shrubs. We talked about grassing over those borders and just leaving the hedges and boxwoods. But then there were all the gardens in gravel with wonderful seedings of flowers and bulbs. How could we possibly simplify those? In the end, we just gave up. I felt stricken for a few weeks after we made the decision to move, periodically dissolving into tears as the enormity of leaving this world I created hit me. But as I slowly accepted the necessity of the move, I felt stirrings of excitement at the thought of finding a new nest. I began dreaming of the possibilities of a move. Less garden, more land. Another quirky old farmhouse. Maybe an apple orchard. A real meadow. We invited young, avid gardening friends to come dig. Not knowing what time of year we would be moving or to where, we wanted pieces of our best plants to find homes elsewhere, ensuring their survival. Double trilliums, yellow snowdrops, epimediums, my collection of anemones and anemonellas, odd-colored violets, apricot, palest yellow, clear pink, species daylilies, iris, roots of my treasured old roses. Bits of these were dug up and parceled out. The house went on the market and, at first, it looked like it might be sold to people who loved the garden. In the end, a neighbor bought Duck Hill for convenience, and we knew the garden was probably doomed. In the fall, before the contract was signed, we dug up a few divisions of perennials we felt sentimental about, as well as some precious bulbs, and these were stored for the winter in pots at a friend's place, lined along their stone wall and covered with leaves. Adam Wheeler of Broken Arrow Nursery came and took cuttings of our roses. But all the woodies, the shrubs and trees we had planted and loved, remained. Our focus turned to dismantling the house, tackling 34 years of accumulation, rooms full of things, many of which, I might add, we still own. We are not minimalists. I remember the day we moved, in the middle of December, looking back at the house, swept clean but desolate, stripped of pictures and books, bibelots, furniture, and rugs, and thinking, okay, I can leave now. We are taking our home with us. Finding a place. Moving north. Our friends were bemused when we said we were moving north, out of New York and into New England. Surely most people our age head south. And as I look out my window on a January morning to freezing rain and sleet, I wonder, were we crazy? Perhaps. But Bosco and I love the change of seasons. I, for one, am more than ready to take a break from gardening in winter, relieved to be forced by frozen soil and single-digit temperatures to call it quits. What a pleasure it is to read books without the weeds calling, to bake cakes and slow-cook stews, to daydream about flowers. I have time to scheme about gardens, to change my mind multiple times on how to improve their design, to plot what plants to add next spring, what seeds to order. Yes, here we have dreary days of freezing rain and the inevitable danger of lurking ice. Yak tracks on our boots are a winter necessity, but we still get excited, childlike, by snow in winter, willing to cope with its inconvenience in exchange for its silence and shadows, loving those sparkling sapphire and diamond days that Bosco says reminds him of the Alps. The long winter months have everything to do with the thrill we experience of emerging spring. The first sight of skunk cabbage, tightly furled and speckled rust red, the sweet smell of earth thawing. To witness the bravest of flowerings, witch hazels, hellebores, snowdrops, aconites, and the tommy crocuses, Crocus thomasinianus. Suddenly, I cannot bear to be inside, overcome with excitement to see what is stirring as each day new bulbs and perennials emerge, some of them friends I forgot we had. As soon as the soil is dry enough, I have every excuse to be outdoors, cleaning up, cutting down, planting trees and shrubs, and sowing lettuces, sweet peas, and spinach. I was astonished the first time I heard from my daughter-in-law about June gloom and May gray in Southern California, where she lives. A weather pattern there in late spring and early summer of overcast days, fog, and drizzle. I thought, but those are my favorite months. I treasure our gorgeously verdant May and June, pristine in their freshness, before bugs, disease, and heat.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.